for strength. That means our strength comes from you. And everything that you already have done, as we praise you, you inhabit the praises of your people as we worship you tonight. There's something that has happened in our heart that has made a way for your word. So bring forth your word by the Spirit. The letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. So I thank you for your word to just come forth in such a way that it will divide between the soul and the spirit, that it will separate everything that's separating us. It will cut it out so that we can go to our next place of glory. So I give you praise, honor, and glory as I decrease that you may increase. Have your way. Have your way. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 So I'm going to read Isaiah 61. And you're going to read it with me. I know you ain't got no ashes, but I'm going to find a few. All right. You have to say it with your own mouth. Something happens when you say it with your own mouth. Ready? 1, 2, 3. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach. To proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to those who are bound. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn. To console all who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. Hallelujah! Tonight I want to talk about the ashes, because I can talk to you tomorrow. We can bring a word on beauty if you don't understand the ashes. Everything in the word of God that God has for us is an answer to something that pertains to us. And you cannot receive the truth if you don't know where the truth is going to correct. The beauty won't mean nothing if you don't understand the ashes. Righteousness don't mean nothing if you don't know what it means not to have it. Freedom don't mean nothing unless you know what it is to be bound. Joy don't mean nothing unless you have ever spent time weeping, crying, kissing the pillow. It won't mean nothing unless you've been there. Peace won't be nothing unless you know it is to be confused and not know where you're gonna go and what you're gonna do. It won't mean nothing to you if you've never been confused. It's only after you walk in a place of freedom that you really realize how much you were bound. It's only after you walk in the truth that you realize that you were living a lie and you didn't even know it. And sometimes we think we're in a place, but it's only when I get out of a place that I can look back and understand where I've been. Because I don't have nothing to compare it to. I can be living in a hole and think it's the top. I can think I'm being loved when I'm being beat up. I can think that I'm being appreciated when I'm being torn apart. I can think I'm being accepted when in fact I'm being rejected. I can think that I'm being talked to the say when in fact I'm being talked about. I don't know what's going on in my life until I get out of it. So before I talk about the beauty, I want to talk about the ashes. Because I believe that a lot of people in the body of Christ right now, this old world is right here in Isaiah. This is a passage that pertains to many places in God's purpose. It pertains to the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ as well as his second coming. It pertains to the nation of Israel as well as the spiritual Israel. It pertains to something that's going to be manifested from glory to glory in a greater degree. But excusez-moi, while I wait for the greater, I'm not going to settle for less than a little bit of glory. I'm not going to settle for nothing while I'm waiting for the whole lot. You know, sometimes we have the tendency to wait for the whole of it. And I know that God, it's when you start receiving the little bit. I remember one day I needed 500 bucks. And God made a way for me to have 300. My first reaction was to say, I still need $200. And the Spirit of the Lord said, if you can praise me for what I just did, in your praise you will believe me for the other 200. And that was when I was first a young believer and I just needed to pay a bill, you know, and that's when he said, you believe me for your salvation? I said, yes, Lord, I'm born again. I have everlasting life. And that's when he said, and you're tripping over a bill. Because if you need, just like in this scripture, the beauty is the glory. The beauty is everything that pertains to him. But you see, tonight I want to talk about pertains to you. It's talking here about people that are mourning. People that are mourning. People that are weeping. They in sackcloth, they have this thing around their head. You know, in those times when they were going through something bad, it wasn't like now where everybody pretends. Like everything is all right. It wasn't like, you know, let me put my makeup on and... It wasn't like that, no. When they were mourning about something, they would take literal ashes, dust, and they would just throw it on their head. And they would take this whole thing and wrap themselves in sackcloth. Everybody knew they were mourning. You try it tomorrow. Go outside and take a little shovel, get some piece of dirt. Forget the hairdo. Throw it on your head. And walk in church. And everybody will look at you like, what happened to you? I'm mourning. It was the way it was. I don't know where the body has gone to. Now nobody knows when you're going through something, except the Lord. And you know how other people know, if they hang around you long enough, eventually it's going to come out. You can't hide it for too long. Eventually it's going to boom. It's better if it boom a little bit at a time, because if you wait, it's going to boom, boom. Somebody's going to get their head shut up. Earlier today, I heard that there was electricity has gone out this whole neighborhood all the way to a block from here. Where did it stop? Did it stop at Circuit City? Where is Carlota? Oh, so right there. Woo! I just want to show you that God wanted this thing to happen tonight. And then there's a dear couple of this church, if you don't mind me sharing. I don't know if your husband is here. Is Anthony here? But I heard, now I don't know exactly the story, but I heard that through circumstances that was hard to explain, the trash in your garage caught on fire. Is that correct? The trash can in their garage caught on fire. I said, praise God. I said, you mean that God used your house to bring us a prophetic picture of what's about to happen up in here tonight? You mean, you better tell Anthony, man of God, you were used by God, you didn't even know it, you probably were tripping. But not really, because, you know, you don't do that. But you were probably wondering what's going on. It was a prophetic thing. Because God told me tonight, when I was in the shower, I said, God, what's going to happen tonight? He said, tonight, you're going to take care of the ashes. He said, not only there's some things that's been in the trash that's going to be burned up. He said, but tonight, I'm going to release the breath of my spirit, and I'm going to blow away every ash. I'm going to blow away everything that has been burned up in the past. Tonight, there's going to be just a mighty release of the wind of the Holy Spirit over your life. Everything of your past is going to be blown away. Oh my. I know you ain't got nothing, but hey, if you want, you can take some of mine. If you want, we can all share. Because see, there's ashes in the Hebrew is a word that really means worthlessness. It means little pieces of nothing that's just spread out everywhere. It's the ashes. It's another word for dust. And we are dust. We are made from dust. Everything that represents the ashes, the dust in the Word of God represents you, your humanity, who you are without Him, who you are. And who you gonna stay apart from Him? Dust, dust, dust. Another word I could use is dirt. Dust, dirt. I'm gonna talk about some dirt. Woman like that. Woman likes to talk about dirt. Maybe not you, but I've heard some, they like to talk about dirt. So when I think about the ashes, they're mourning and they put it on their head, it represents everything that they regret, everything that they are sad, everything in their lives that have brought sorrow, not just things past, but things present and things to come. And in our lives, there's a lot of things that have happened that have brought sorrow in our lives, that has really just been like so much in our hearts, so much in our lives has been burned. You ever been burned? You ever been in a place that you went through something and you're tired of going through the same thing and you feel like you've been burned? And you wept so much about the same thing that you don't even want to go to another thing because you rather not go through anything than to go to the same thing again. That you had a point that you said, no, I'm gonna mourn and I'm gonna weep and I'm just gonna stay right here. See, for me, the ashes, what it represents, is the areas of my life where pain has brought me to a place that instead of believing for the glory, all I could see was the dust, all I could see was the dirt, that my eyes, instead of being able to be upon Him as much as I would try to behold Him. And what I'm telling you is not something out of a book. I've lived it. I continue to live it. I continue to remind myself that lest I behold Him, lest I behold Him. But if I behold Him and I think of Him apart from me, then it doesn't work either. Because the scripture tells us that we have this treasure in earthen vessel, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. So you see, there's the treasure and there's the earthen vessel. And I can think of the treasure, but to me it makes no sense at all. I can believe for this treasure to be in this earthen vessel without this earthen vessel to be all right. Like the sun. pain. But when I look at the dust, when I look at who I am, and the day that I can finally realize this is dust. Amen. Amen. This is the day that I realized that I was nothing without him. It's the day that I was able to reach forth everything that he was. You see, the walk in God, and to be able, even in these next few days, we're going to go through practical application. We're gonna do this little treasure hunt. I'm not going to tell you what's in here. Going to have to come tomorrow. See what's in here. But we're going to have to do a treasure hunt in our lives. And you know what a treasure hunt is? Is that you go from glory to glory, and with every place of glory, you're getting harder. Getting harder. You're getting closer. With every time you hear a word, every time the Lord speaks to you, every time that you mourn and he dries your tears, you're getting closer, you're getting harder, you're getting closer. Every time that you think that you have no more breath to even praise him, and he gives you the breath and the strength, because I know we don't have it, it's him that gives you the strength to praise him one more time. Every time, woman of God, I know tonight you're here, because I can tell you, you're getting harder, you're getting closer, you're almost there. It's almost like you know, the dirt is what creates the pearl in an oyster. The oyster is in the water. When the piece of dirt comes, when the dust comes, the oyster is like, what on earth is happening? The pearl cannot be formed without the dirt going inside the oyster. Every dirt that has been thrown at you in your life, every dust that ever has happened, even though you don't know it, it's been forming you. I look at you and I see this beautiful pearl that's being formed, this beautiful pearl that's being formed. What does it mean, the dust, the humanity in our lives? The first thing I can think of is the way that I see dirt in myself. When in me I see dwelleth no good thing. But then I take another look and I see him. I look in the mirror again and I see him in me. Christ in me, the hope of glory. When I get to a point, my confidence no longer is in myself, but my confidence is in him. When my assurance and my confidence is not in who I am, but in who he is. When I know that I cannot, but he can. When I know that I'm not able, but he is able. When I know that I might be down, but he can take me up. When I know that I'm just a pot of clay, but he can take me from pot to the top. Hallelujah! He can take me from the pot to the top. He can see me as this broken vessel. And the more I thought I was broken, and the more I thought I was in pieces and useless and worthless, he comes and he just said, "No, well, what are you throwing this piece away for? Lord, well, what you gonna do with that? Well, what you gonna do? That's worthless, God. That's nothing. That a lot of people, God, they can sing better than me. A lot of people, God, they can write better than me. They can speak better than me. They can pray better than me. That's useless. That's worthless, God. That's just like I am. Everything about me is worthless. Everything, no matter how much, I have no worth whatsoever, God. And God, at that very moment, says, "Whoa. Now, I can work. Now, I can do something, because you realize that apart from me, you can do nothing. But now, what you call worthless, move out of my way, my little girl. Just, you know what, my child? Just go over there and take a seat. Just go over there and take a seat, because I'm going to take what you call worthless. I'm going to take this broken this broken vessel. I'm going to take this cracked pot. I'm going to take this pot that used to be hooked on crack. I'm going to take this pot that was worthless to the world. I'm going to take this pot that was broken in so many pieces that they didn't have any peace. I'm going to take this pot. And this pot's going to be mine. And this pot, I'm going to put myself in it. This pot, I'm going to put myself in it. And now you're going to see that just by my very presence, the peace is going to be put back together. Just by me being here, what was worthless going to be worth a lot. Just by my very presence, everything in your life is going to change. I don't know if you've been there. I don't know if you've ever been there, that you felt so worthless because you had said the wrong thing again. You had done the wrong thing again. That you were face to face with your own humanity. That you thought, well, I got it, breakthrough, hallelujah. I went to conference 2000, I went through so many conferences. I keep on going to conferences, and I think I got one piece, and then I think I got the victory, and then the Monday come, and here I go, all broken again. And every time I get broken is when other people, they throw dirt back at me. It's when other people, they don't see the glory in me. They remind me constantly. Have you ever been in a relationship in your life, whether it's with friends or exes, that's why the exes, or current ones, that no matter what you did, didn't matter. Because you felt that people around you, they couldn't see you. They couldn't understand you. They couldn't see you. That every time they were looking at you, you knew they were seeing the dust, not the glory. They were looking at you. They were looking at the place that's broken. They couldn't see the place that God just put together. So the same way that I was talking about praising God for the 300, were you waiting for the 200? You were like, can somebody just be happy because there's one piece that's back together? Can you just be happy because there's something that God is doing? Can you stop looking at what God is still working on and at least start praising Him with me for what He has done? Because if my God has done this much, then surely He's going to do some more. So can you just, excuse me, but can you just be happy a little bit for me? I'm not asking you to look at me. I'm asking you to look at the Christ, what He did in my life. I'm not even asking you, don't even look at me, but look at what God has done. Look at what He has done in my life. Have you ever been to this place? Because, you know, the scripture tells us in the New Testament that Jesus told them, can you put Acts, I don't remember, I think it's Acts 13, the thing, verse 50-51. I want to show you the New Testament, the disciples, you know, they were told, if you go to a city and they don't receive you, then you leave that place and you shake the dust of your feet. And He says, not only you shake the dust of your feet, but He says, then you tell them, hey, nevertheless, I'll shake the dust of my feet. But because you don't receive me and you reject the Christ, because you cannot see who I am, then nevertheless, who I am has just come upon you. Whether you see it or not, the Christ has just walked in. So whether you can receive it or not, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Hallelujah. Doesn't matter, because you see, it's not you. So whether people receive it or not, the kingdom has just come. Whether they know it or not, when you walked into the place and you sent by God and you come forth and you've been transformed, you're not all the way there yet. But you know, that's just people around you and the enemy, they always want to try to make you focus on what's missing. always on what's missing. I want you to start thanking him and praising him for what he has done. Because in that praise is the key to your victory for him to do more. It's in that place of what's not what's missing. I'm not looking at what's missing, but what God has done. Huh? You know, it has set you free. Because otherwise you live your whole life waiting for something more. We're always waiting for something more. But if God has done this much, that's why he said, hey, Spirit of the Lord, God has come upon me. Not only that, but then if you continue, I'm excited about today and tomorrow, because not only that, but he said, hey, I'm going to give you double. Said, I'm going to give you double. Not only what people have not received, he said, I'm going to double it up. But here it says, but the Jews stirred up the devout and prominent women and the chief men of the city, raised up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region. See, there's a place in God that you're not, because the enemy has stirred up some stuff against you. There's some people that have thrown dirt at you. They have talked about you. They have thrown dust at you. You know what? Sometimes it wasn't even on you that was dust. It's some people threw dirt on somebody else and you were just happened to just be around. It wasn't even your dirt. Like you didn't have enough dirt on your own. I have to tell the people, excusez-moi, but I got enough dirt on my own. You can bring dirt to yourself. I'm having enough hard time shaking the dust of my own feet. Have you ever been to the beach and you have those sand in your shoes? You have dust in your shoes and you move it and you shake it and it feels really uncomfortable and it's just messing up your walk, this dust in your shoes. Everything that pertains to your mistakes, everything that pertains to what you could have done, should have done, could have been, would have been, all this is dust. Tonight, the Lord is going to blow it out of your life quicker than you can think. Quicker than you can. You know why? Because the opposite is true. If you focus on what's missing, not only you won't be satisfied where you are, but instead of walking in the next place in God, it will pull you back where you were before that thing happened. So in other words, if I'm there complaining that I don't have the 200 yet, and if I continue to complain that the 200 is not there yet, next thing I know, I'm going to be acting and talking and living like I don't even have the 300. Like it's not even here. And the Lord is like, what am I, mashed potatoes? I gave you 300. I don't think he would say it like that. It's Dr. J interpretation. Because he would feel like, I mean, even in our lives, when you do something for someone, your children, your grandchildren, and they forget appreciating it. Let's not even ask for a thank you. Let's even be okay. We know thank you. Okay, let's say, well, I'm doing it unto the Lord. I give you that much. All right, give you, okay. No, they do the opposite. They act like what you did was never done. Like you did was not good enough. Like, you know, Janet Jackson old song. What have you done for me lately? Whoa, whoa, whoa. After a while, you know, you just don't want to do nothing no more. Won't do nothing no more. Because the little, the little bit of things that's no longer dust, they turn it into dust. Instead of you being able to go to the next place, there's these things that happen that you feel it's not going to work. If it's like that with children, it's like that with mates sometimes. You know, even you with a man in your life, you have to start. Because listen, what I'm saying that pertains to you, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That means if you would like to be appreciated, if you would like, whoa, no, Pastor, go back to the other way. It's better if we just talk about them doing that to us. But are you sure we also have to be like that with them? Yeah. Something happened. When you married, if you married and you're in this place, and there's the one day that he picks up one sock. One. Don't be going in the house like, phew. Can't believe you never pick up your socks. But, no, it's always like that, you never pick up your... Never mind, I'll do it myself. But honey, I picked up... But the day that you walk in and... Honey. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory, hallelujah, I knew this day was going to happen. Oh, I'm so happy. Did you really pick up that sock? Oh. Oh, honey, what you want for dinner? I make your favorite dish. This is, I knew, what a breakthrough. I just appreciate you so much. I appreciate you so much. Wait until I tell all the ladies at work what a big help you are. That really, without you, I couldn't be me. Oh, I can't wait. Oh, I praise God for you. Thank you, Jesus, for this man. You know what would happen? The next day you walk in, both socks are picked up. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! It works! Same thing for the dishes. Even if you have to do them when you sleep again. If you can just say, oh, you did the dishes. Even if you didn't do it right. Something happened when you start appreciating people for the little bit. Something happened that they'll do everything they can to bring them more. You know why? Because instead of stirring up the dust, you're stirring up the glory. Instead of talking about who they used to be, you talk about who they become. Instead of talking about what you always complain about, you start speaking things that are not as though they are. You have to start seeing things in the spirit and be able to appreciate those around you, and for you to even do that to yourself. The enemy don't need to beat you up. You're doing that perfectly all by yourself. You don't need to do it. He doesn't need to do nothing. You there. I'm so bad. I'm always making mistakes. I'm always this. Ay, 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 ay. Do you know how many people do not pray out loud? Because one day they prayed and as soon as they went home, see, you said the wrong thing. Next time you shouldn't even be praying. What you said don't matter anyway. So then you come back to church. No, you have to start saying, thank you, God, that there was a time I would never have opened my mouth. Thank you, God, there was a time I wouldn't even have been able to pray, let alone in a group. Maybe I messed up the scriptures. Maybe I said James and it was Luke. But I opened my mouth. I opened my mouth. Same thing for singing. I used not to be able to sing. I used to always say, I can't sing. And the Lord one day, spiritual spanking, that's what that means. And he said, do you realize what you're saying? I said, yeah, I can't sing. He said, the day that you stop putting yourself down for something you cannot do, maybe I can do it through you. Then one day I heard coming out of my mouth, hallelujah. And I was like, whoo, hee. Maybe I didn't sound like Minister of Music Winona. Maybe I didn't sound like, Vanita. Maybe I didn't sound like, but I sounded like me. It was my voice that came out. Hallelujah. It was me, that song. And to me, that was a breakthrough. It was a breakthrough for me to do that. The dust is what's messing us up. We throw it at ourselves. We let other people throw it at us. All people talk about is they complain because all they focus on is the dust, is the ashes, is the... And the Lord says, shake the dust off your feet. You know, because if it stays on you, you can't go to the next place. You have to start looking. You know, it's the best way for you to lose weight. You ever try to lose weight and you get on the scale? I only lost 1 pound. I still have 19 to go. How are you doing on your diet? I still have 19 pounds to lose. I'm never going to make it. You realize how much 19 pounds is? I'm never going to make it. Actually, you know what? Pass the bonbons. Because you see what I just did? That's exactly what we do. Instead of saying, woo-wee! I lost one. How you doing? I lost one. You did? I lost one. That's when you don't want friends that are around and they say, and how many you trying to? You don't want the friends. You have to pick your friends. Or don't tell them what you're trying to do. You don't want somebody to say, you know, oh, you look so, yeah, I lost 1 pound. Oh, you did? How many you still trying to lose? Well, because they want to talk about what's missing. Don't have people in your life that always talk about what's missing. We need to be able to see what God has done so that we can be able to be transformed from glory to glory. Oh my God, I feel a message coming on. I'm just starting. They were expelled. So then you know what they did? They were expelled. Rejected, taking out of the place where they were supposed to be, because some people stirred up something. You know, if you ever been in a group of friends, and next thing you know, you come, you're like, something happened. You don't know what, but something's been stirred up. People are, I call it the look. And you're wondering, will you walk in the womb? They were your bodies. They were your friends. You were like that. You walk in and silence. They're looking at each other. And they're giving you the look. I can't try to do it, but. You feel rejected. You feel you just got expelled from a place that you used to be accepted in. You feel like something got stirred behind your back. And because it was behind your back, you feel that it was so much dust that some people have taken a shovel. They dug out so much dirt. And this is the first thing you think. What did I tell one of them that they might have told some? What kind of dirt got digged up? What kind of dirt got talked about that never existed? What got stirred up behind my back? Because you know what? When there's some dirt that's stirred up, people are digging a hole. And then it's at that moment that you have to be careful not to fall in it. It's at that very moment when you step in a room. And this example is not just friends. At your job, at the church, especially if you just got done singing a song in the choir, especially if you just started obeying God and doing anything in the church. I never had dirt thrown at me until I said yes to God. Suddenly I had people that were giving me the look. And I was like, praise God. Before I was invisible, at least now I get the look. There must be something. There must be something in me that's stirring up the dirt. There must be something in me that's stirring up the enemy that's trying to put me back in the hole. There must be something in me that the enemy's trying to tear me down. There must be something in me. There must be a purpose. There must be glory. Hallelujah. God must be taking me from glory to glory for this day. It wouldn't be stirred up. So next time that happens and you step into a room, instead of going in the hall, say, "Whoo, glory, hallelujah, wow!" Just get really happy. And even before you send it, don't even ask them. See, because we want people to tell us. You know, we say, "What? What is it?" They're not gonna tell you anyway. So why ask? No, you go in and you say, they say, "You got the Holy Ghost? You better believe that I got the Holy Ghost. You better believe when I'm shaking the dust of my feet. You better believe. You have got to understand." Oh, one day I went in a place where they had asked all the people that had been touched with the fire of revival in Brownsville. They said, "All you ministers, come up and pray for the people." And I stood up and I was there with other ministers. And everybody started going in lines with other people. And I started looking around and I said, I'm the only woman. Nobody's in waiting in my line. They want the fire of revival, but they're looking at the container that's going to bring it. And I didn't even notice I was a woman until I asked the Lord, how come there's... until I said, why is there 10 people waiting in line over here, 10 people waiting in line over there, and there's nobody in my line. So I said, Lord, what should I do? Because I almost went into the hole. Now I almost went to sit down. When the Lord says, watch, and I watch, and people were looking for the revival fire, and nothing happened. And suddenly, one person came in my line. Before that person was, I was like that. And then, and that person came, and I did. He went down. The one on the right went down. The one on the left went down. Hallelujah! Glory! Because God said, hey, it's not coming in the vessel that you look at. It's not coming the way that you want it to come. And when rejection comes and things happen to put you in the hole, to put you back dust to dust, you can rise up and say, no, I'm going from dust to glory. I'm going back from dust to dust. You can put me back in the hole that God got me out of. He pulled me out of the hole. You can put me back in. Hallelujah. So they shook the dust of their feet against them. And they came to Iconium. You want to know what happened when they shook the dust up? Oh, I'm telling you, I don't know who's waiting for you back home tonight. But oh, whoa, especially when you go in and you get this glory all over us, because we're going to blow the dust off, and you go home and they say, I thought you went to church. I did. And you come home and you said, oh, the house looks nice. And you... and somebody says, well, it's really late. Well, where you got to be at church all the time? You going back there tomorrow? Yes. And I'm so happy that I can because of the kind of person that you are. I'm so happy that because of your support, I can go receive from the Lord tomorrow for both of us. I'm so happy. It'll change everything. So I'm going to tell you what happened because, ooh, it's 10 till 9. I need to just, because tonight I'm just going to, I was in the shower and I said, Lord, what's going to happen tonight? He said, tonight the breath of God's going to bring forth the revival and you're going to blow on everyone. And he said, it's my breath that's going to touch them like never before. All the dust in their life, it's going to just be blown away, to the point that you're going to be blown away. Hallelujah. People around you, they're going to be blown away. Blown away, because when the dirt is gone, you can finally walk, you can finally see where your feet are, you can finally walk. So tonight, whoa, whoa. So I'm going to show you what it says. Put it to verse 50. And the disciples were filled with joy. Just got expelled. Just got kicked out. You know when the fire of God comes upon you, mighty woman of God? Every time someone fires you, you get more on fire. Every time someone say, you're fired, you said, thank you for speaking this into my life. No, you didn't hear me. I said you were laid off, you fired. No, you didn't hear me. You fire me, I become hotter. I become closer. I'm getting closer. You expel me, I'm not gonna cry. I'm gonna be filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. Because if I just get fired, if I just get expelled, you just actually set me up for greater glory. You just actually, no. One day I saw myself, you know, just like people receive the Academy Awards. And I was saying, I just want to thank all the people that have talked about me. I just want to take a moment and talk to everyone that threw dirt at me. I just want to thank you. I thank you. I thank you for coming against what God was doing. I thank you for firing me. I thank you. Hallelujah! Glory! Jesus! I thank you. I thank you, because every time you wanted to throw me back in the hole, I became more whole. Every time you thought you had put me back to the, I just started, whoo, you want the anointing to grow in your life? Whoa, 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 slap me on the right. Kick me on the left. Come on, make my day. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Everybody get up! Woo! Oh, tonight we're getting the dust up. So before tonight, everybody gonna come up and I'm just gonna release the breath of the Holy Ghost upon you. Tomorrow, between all the services, we're gonna pray for you even more in detail. But tonight I believe prophetically that the dust is supposed to be moved away. Do you understand what that means? There's going to be an anointing that comes through the breath of the Holy Ghost. Ooh! It's going to be like an encounter of the Holy Ghost kind. It's going to be like a bubbling forth. Last month, the Lord says, I'm releasing the jacuzzi anointing. The jacuzzi anointing, did you feel it? It's the jacuzzi anointing that the Lord showed me. There's going to be, there's going to be the breath of the truth. It's going to be the thing that's going to come. Is there anyone in this room tonight that's not coming tomorrow? The people that can't be here tomorrow, how will I know who they are? Come right there so that I'll know. Hallelujah. Gee, all of you are coming tomorrow? God about the machine. Hallelujah. Then start bringing everybody else, because I'm going to start releasing the breath of the Holy Ghost. Shema ha se demote, e ma ha yekemo.